Alright, hello everyone, welcome to another one-shot video. I am SIMSteven, also known as Master Fenrel. And today we'll be doing a very early PS1 game. A game that I think originally was being developed for PC, but then Sony's like, hey, come our way and we'll port it to your... You can port it to our console and we'll shake hands and all that. Either way, we got some aliens attacking innocent civilians here, and... Surprised me that this particular series is still going on today, considering the fact that I don't even know if Microprose, the developer, is even around, or if the rights got bought out or something. But I've seen recent iterations of the series on game shelves as I just go browsing in various stores and all that. But this is, I believe, is the very first game in the series. It's also the only one I've ever played, so forgive me for not being up to date with the more recent games in the series, but this is one of the first games I own for my PS1, and it is XCOM UFO Defense. Yeah, the XCOM series, like I said, is still going on today, and I believe this is where it got its first start, was very early on in the PS1 era. Now, I believe... Well, I really haven't actually played my save file in quite a while. I did just take a quick glance on it before starting this recording, so I kind of have a general idea where I was at. But, yeah, one of the reasons why I do one-shot Let's Plays is because I don't feel they make for good Let's Play material. So, if I still want to show a video of it, I dedicate one video, hence the name One Shot, to showing off just some of the few features and gameplay mechanics of said game. So, XCOM UFO Defense is a strategy slash turn-based strategy game. You have two parts to the strategy. The first is Geoscape mode, where we have all of the world here. And we can place our bases on various points in the world. All the green blinking dots on the map here are bases I've built. And, well, we started, if you look on the right side where the clock is, we originally started in January of 1999. So it's been 4 months of gameplay, roughly. But I have some very impressive bases, and I take advantage of some glitches and so on and so forth. I've played through the game through numerous times, but this is very much a perfectionist run. You can see I've got lots of facilities in my main base, and I've got a couple other bases in other countries as well. I name them, because you get free reign over how you name each of your bases. I name them based on what country I put them in, or which region of the world, so like North Asia, South Asia, Europe, Africa. I'm going to have one, I think, in Australia eventually, and one in Antarctica. But I always start in North America because the North American patrons, or governments, they tend to be the highest paying of in the entire game, so that's why you usually start, is I want to protect the good old USA and their capitalist nature. And you can see I've made quite a lot of... I make quite a lot of money from each of the world countries every single month. But my main goal and why I cheat so much is to prevent an alien infiltration mission. And I believe if we go and alien research my database... we could actually get some information on what the alien infiltration missions are. Basically, you could probably read this yourself, but essentially they send out a bunch of alien spaceships to a general area of the world, and they basically strike a deal with one of the governments where they basically cut your funding, and certain countries will no longer fund you. So, I believe it is a permanent loss, although I've heard rumors that countries may start funding you after a while, just if you start doing well once again. But I try to prevent that at all costs, which is why I exploit as much of the game as I possibly can. And one of those big exploits, let me show it off here. You can see I've got 200 scientists in this base. And if we look at our monthly costs, our scientists cost $6 million by themselves. So that's a huge payroll to compensate for. In fact, I think the monthly cost of just this one base alone isn't enough for what all the world countries pay me at the end of the month. So there is a glitch where you can transfer like personnel and aircraft. And if they're in transit at the end of the month when that the salary rolls over, you don't have to pay them. So they're working for me and they're working for free. So that's one big thing. In addition, I end up doing quite a good job despite the fact that I only have one radar system in the entire world right now. Well, this isn't an exploit, unless you consider saving and reloading an exploit. If you look at the graphs, you can actually see where UFO activity is. And you can go by region. You know, I've had a lot of aliens that I've shut down in North America. And there's usually a bunch over in Asia. Kind of the Japanese-China area. But if you use your graphs, you can tell where aliens are hanging out at. And it's kind of preset at the beginning of the month, and it's the game essentially preloads where UFOs will spawn over the next several, like, 30 days or month and a half or so. And what you can do is you can just save and roll the month out a little while, and you can shoot, you can predict where they're going to be based on what's been preset. Now, it's kind of starting to lag a little bit here, and things are going a bit slower. That means there's UFOs going around somewhere right now. But my radars aren't picking it up. Well, my one singular radar base is not picking it up, because I think he's probably out of range or evading detection or something like that. At the end of that day, some research had been completed. And we'll get into some of that in a minute. Well, actually, let's just put some scientists. Let's put one scientist, because I'm not even going to save my progress here. I'm going to restart and do things over next time I actually play and start from where I started off. Let's go over some of the things you can do to thwart the alien menace. First of all, you got a bunch of soldiers here, and you can review their information here in your base. I actually just renamed them all based on various characters in various games. And if I have throwaway soldiers, I name them like Kenny or Timmy, because South Park and dinosaurs. We need another Timmy, and oh my god, they killed Kenny! that's where the jokes come from, if you get the references. We also have aircraft we can use to intercept and attack UFOs. Firestorm is the round circular one in the upper left corner. The Lightning is the top middle. Sky Ranger is in the top right. This is basically just an attack aircraft. This one can both attack and do ground-based missions, and the Sky Ranger is strictly ground-based missions. And here's the Firestorm in this hangar, here's the Lightning in this hangar, and here's the Sky Ranger in this hangar. In this hangar, I believe it's actually occupied because I'm actually manufacturing an Avenger, which is an aircraft that it's basically the ultimate craft in the game. It has the most range. It can go for long periods of time. It's basically a hybrid, once again, like the Lightning aircraft, where you can do air battles and ground battles. And it's got like all the highest stats, the best defense, and if you want to take down battleships, that's the only safe craft to use. Also interceptors here, which I still got some of the old aircraft that we originally started with. But yeah, I kind of bought a few as well, so that's where a lot of my extra money goes. Really, the best way to get money is actually to do as many ground missions as you possibly can. and sell all the alien weaponry you can manage to pick up. And, well, research, just keep going around for research and sell the rest, and build your own weapons. The biggest piece of advice I can have is research laser weapons as soon as possible. It's something that's available to research from the start. But laser rifles, so you can see I've got a bunch here in the Sky Ranger here. These laser rifles are probably one of the best weapons in the game. You can get them fairly early on as well. You just have to build them in your workshops and all that. But they're accurate, they're powerful, and there's only two alien types, I remember. If I remember this right, I believe there's only two alien types that are strong against it, and I believe they're both terrorist units, so you only see them in certain situations. So yeah, aside from that, well, the alien plasma weapons are the strongest overall, but those also require ammo, which we have to buy or build. You can't buy the ammo, but you have to build ammo or save it from whenever you do ground missions and, you know, take it from the aliens and use it against them and all that. But I really don't like to use plasma weapons unless I'm going on to the final mission of the game where you beat the game. Aside from that, this game is 100% gameplay, so let's try and get some gameplay in here and maybe shoot down some UFOs or do a ground-based mission. Now, as I said, about half the game, or half the strategy of the game, or just half the game in general, takes place here on the world map where you're trying to shoot down alien aircrafts or intercept them from performing their missions. It's kind of lagging here, so maybe there's some alien activity going on somewhere else. I don't particularly care right now. And some facilities in Africa were built. So probably what I would do here after that pops up is maybe... okay, so I didn't want to build another base. I don't have the money for that right now. What am I doing in the other bases? I got there. I forget. That looks like... oh, that's a grav shield. Alright, so that's an anti-alien... basically, if aliens attack me, the grav shield will repel their spacecraft, and it'll give my weapons systems a chance to shoot back at them. But I haven't actually built any of those weapon systems because, well, more loot at the end of the battle if you kill off some of the aliens before they actually get in your base if they decide to attack. And speaking of which, if aliens do decide to attack your bases, I suggest having a setup similar to this. We have your hangars all on one end, and the access lift. Every base must have an access lift because your bases are underground. In order for your supplies to get to and from your base, you have to have the access lift to, you know, move supplies and all that. That's kind of the logistics of it. But basically have like your living quarters here in the center where all your soldiers will be at the start of battle, and when aliens attack, they'll come in either through access lifts or the hangars. So this basically makes it a big choke point for the aliens, a big advantage for you if you're defending your base. Also put general storage areas next to your troops, so your tanks can attack them, and so on and so forth. But eventually, I think what my plan is to make like a grav shield here, and maybe make some missile silos on the sides, workshops in the bottom here, maybe some psi labs so my troops can get... you know, psychic attack training, which is something you can get after a while. I haven't actually gotten to that point, but you kind of get the idea. I think in general what I do in the general layouts of my bases is I put general storage all along the bottom, a couple living quarters, workshops on either side, and psi labs, I believe a grav shield, missile silos, and I leave these five spaces blank on the either side here of the access lift. I think there's also one thing here, like a mind shield or something like that, so it prevents aliens from using their psychic powers to locate our base. And also have things like, what was that other facility that I don't have yet? Anyways, this is probably going over everyone's head, regardless. So let's go back to some of the more basics. You can build facilities, as I was just talking about. You can research aliens and their equipment that they have, as well as some of your own things. Like, you can research a medical kit or laser weaponry and stuff like that. You can manufacture your own stuff, so you can use some of the alien parts that you capture and build, like, these aircrafts that I have. Or you can build weapons to use against them in battle, or some tanks and so on and so forth to assist you in ground missions. And a few other things, you can purchase things, obviously, like rifles and grenades and stuff, and also transfer between bases. So those, we've kind of gone over everything here. As well as this here. I do all my research in my main base, which is why I'm not following my usual code of how everything goes and putting everything where it belongs. But, oh yeah, and I also eventually have a special radar in all my bases. I think that's what this plot was for. Eventually I'll have a special radar in this spot in all my bases, which is a hyperwave decoder, which is a super powerful radar that detects everything that comes within range. But I haven't actually researched that yet. But yeah, you can also capture live aliens and they'll get put in here in the alien containment facility. That's how you get a lot of the research that you can't normally get, such as you get info on various UFOs. You can get info on the missions they perform, and so on and so forth, as well as biology of certain aliens, which you can't actually capture certain ones alive. Right, so, like, okay, so now we don't need that. Let's see here, alien life forms. And do I have some of the ones that I know? So, there are basically five different races of aliens that you'll encounter in your ground missions. There's the classic sectoid, and you can also get an autopsy on their corpses, so you can get an idea of what types of weapons work on them. There are snake men, and there are floaters. Those are three of the five main races. I don't believe I've encountered the last two, which I believe are Muton. In other reels, and other reels are a major pain and also the worst race to face in combat, because they'll just make your troops panic because they have psychic attacks out the ass, and they are just a pain to deal with. Anywho, let's try and get a ground mission or air combat so we can actually show off a bit of the gameplay that this game has to offer. And I don't really care too much about how well I do. I'm not actually saving any of this progress that I'm doing here. I actually tend to play a bit more rigorously, which is why I have so much at this early stage in the game, only 4 months in, and I've got 6 bases and they're already on their way to being fully equipped. But like, one of the big things I do or have been doing is just anytime it gets slow and laggy like this, I will send airships out and try to attack, I try to down every single UFO I possibly can, every single one that spawns, and I think lightning will do okay. This is a small UFO. Let's zoom in here and watch the air combat. And once again, this game is like 100% gameplay, aside from if you beat the game and watch the final cutscene. Because there's like no story whatsoever, any dialogue or whatever. It's pretty much going to be in the databases that we were looking at a second ago. And speaking of which, in addition to the five main alien races, there are... there are terrorist units that go along with them. So, the sectoids will have an enemy known as a cyber disc. floaters will have reapers, snake men will have the worst alien type in the game, which is known as the chrysalid. The mutants will have two different kinds, but I forget their name and they're very hard to pronounce either way. And the other reels will have sectopods. Now, the cyberdiscs and the sectopods are mechanical creatures. They're very strong against the laser weapons that I have because, well, they're mechanical and all that. But you can still take them down reasonably well enough if you have enough people to do your attacking. But we downed a UFO, and we're waiting a long time for this game to load. Once again, I said at the beginning of this that this game was originally developed for PC, and then they ported it to the PlayStation. And kind of a fun trivia about that. Back in the early days of the PlayStation, I don't think production companies really had standardized how they were going to do things. Because back in the day, did I have a weapon for all my characters? Yeah, I do. Like I said, I'm not going to bother. I'm not going to save my data at the very end of this, but in case I want to capture aliens live, I have this weapon here. And this mind probe thing here allows me to identify what type of alien it is. And it's very important if you want... Oh, crap. I only have one person in this ship. I did not fully equip it. whoops. So if my one person dies... Oh, crap. It's a mutant. I have not actually encountered this race here, so I know what I'm in for later on when I pick this up and start playing it again. Uh-oh. Well, please don't react and shoot me and kill me. Alright, run away, run away! Back in the ship. Oh no, dang it. I'm out of time units and I'm probably dead. Or not. Oops. Where'd he go? And this is why this is a strategy game, because you gotta really be careful with all your movements here. Let's see here. And what is this guy? This guy is looking straight at me. That guy is looking off to the side. I'm going to see if I can do this as a one-man... a one-man army here. He's not reacting to the shots. That's kind of weird. Maybe he's out of time units? I don't know. End my turn. Get shot at. Die. Or not. Alright, so, let's try and take this guy down. I hope I don't die. Wow, my aim is terrible today. I shot above him! Got one hit on him, but these guys have very resilient skin. Think of, like, orcs in a fantasy setting. That's what these guys are basically representing. Get over by the wall here so that I have some coverage. And I know there's a guy over there. This is a small UFO, so there I think there are at most 8 aliens in this particular type of UFO. I did preview the UFO before I took it down when I was back on the Geoscape. Alright, so turn around and look that way. And end our turn. See if we can spot the alien moving around. I'm hearing doors being opened. And I can actually tell that there's an alien here in this building, because that door is open. I'll run around the side here, and I'm going to crouch and see if I can use a reaction shot to attack the guy if he comes out that door. Alright, well, he's standing there, and I've got a free shot to kill him. And he's very close by, too. And crouching also makes it so your shots are more accurate. As well as, let's see here, I hope that was the last one. I do want to point out one thing here, if I possibly can, if there's more aliens hanging around. But one thing that took me forever to figure out is you can actually open up doors without actually walking through. Normally, if you open a door or move to the square on the other side of a door, your character will also walk through, and you can't actually open a door without actually making a step, and that's very important if you are trying to tackle a UFO or something like that, and there's aliens on the other side, and they will oftentimes use a reaction shot to attack you as you're stepping inside. There are two ways to actually open a door without actually moving. First is to go into point-and-click interface, and this works more like a mouse cursor would. You can select the square and press circle, and that will open the door without moving. The other way of doing that is, there is a way to do it in hotspot interface, which is my preference. I'm going to try and show it off here, just making sure there's no aliens over there. See how I'm right here next to the door, and I'm actually facing the door? If I press down, left, and I believe it's select at the same time, while my cursor is right here on the other side of the door. Or was it circle? No, circle opens up the menu. I know it's like... No, the triangle opens up the menu. So there is supposed to be a button combinations where you can actually open up a door up, and I forget, but I'm pretty sure you have to be facing the door, have your cursor on the other side of the door, and at the same time, you have to push three buttons simultaneously. I don't remember what it was. Alright, so let's try closing this door here. Oh, I pushed start. Alright, so that's how I was able to do that. I knew it had to be like start or select, because it was something I figured out last time I played, and I actually had to look into the manual to figure that out. And, well, as I was talking about before, one interesting thing about the production of this game and how I feel like back in the day, developers didn't really have any standards in production in the early days of the PlayStation 1, is that I think that, well, most people have probably seen these by now, but a lot of the early PS1 games had boxes of varying sizes. So, for the example, for XCOM here, the jewel case is actually bigger than a PS2 DVD case, which is a lot bigger than a CD case if you've ever seen, you know, either of them in compared sizes, of course. But yeah, this is kind of one of those interesting little bits of trivia, is that this game has an extra large box that it originally came in. And I have it here in my room. I'm looking to see, where is the next alien? That is not around here, that's for sure. It's probably in the spaceship, so I'm going to have to take a look and see where the alien ship is that I downed earlier. Can I take a look at my map and see if I get a bird's eye view? Oh, I don't know where that spaceship is, so it's probably in a part of the map I haven't explored yet. So we're just going to take a look around, see if we can find an alien spaceship, because usually there's at least one alien inside it. It's usually the navigator or the engineers, the ones that survived after being shot down and all that. That's over there. Turned around. There's a spaceship. So I'm gonna run over there. These cornfields take forever to get through, by the way. Oh crap, and there was one in that building I was just in, he was upstairs. So I failed, I lost all my troops, and subsequently I lost that spaceship. But you got the idea, it's a strategy-based game, you lose all your characters, you lose your shit, there are real consequences for failure and all that. That's one of the things I like about this game is that, you know, it's all about the gameplay. Everything you do affects everything that you will do. And, well, very perfectionist, in a very perfectionist way, I don't lose any troops. If I have to get rid of any troops because they're just pieces of crap and their stats don't grow like I want them to, I will pretty much just, fire them rather than let them die in battle. It's a lot preferable because that affects your score either way. If you lose soldiers in battle, it'll affect your score, which in turn will affect your funding at the end of the month. So I actually do a lot of saves coming in battle. You can actually save while you're in battle, but I prefer to do that on a different memory card whenever I do go into battle and save in battle. I prefer to save in a different memory card. I've actually got one or two memory cards that I dedicate to in-battle saves. For when I save in the middle of battle. And it's very helpful to getting good scores in terrorist attacks, or when I assault an alien base, or when they assault my alien bases. The bigger ground missions, not quite like when I was just salvaging the UFO a second ago, but I'm just going to load my data here, and we're back to where we were. So, I guess that's just a basic showing of what happens in the game. I definitely won't be doing ground missions with that lightning anytime soon until I put some actual soldiers in there. I need to hire some more. aside from that, that's basically an overall showing of the game. You have your air combat missions where you shoot down alien aircrafts. You have your ground missions where you're going to salvage alien weapons and corpses and all that. And here's a UFO we didn't spot before. So, it's a very small one. I can probably do this with my lightning. Very small UFOs only have one alien inside them. And if I shoot him down, these are very frail, by the way. If I shoot this thing down and I actually get a crash landing, I can actually go and try and catch him. But I destroyed it. And normally when I'm playing by myself, I would save before doing that. Because I want to make them crash land, because I want to do the ground missions. Ground missions are where you get all your money. Is you go in, you kill the aliens on foot. That also increases your overall score for the month, because you get points for killing aliens. And you also get their weapons, and you get to recover any parts from their ships as well. And that's how you get a lot of money, is you sell all that extra stuff that you don't need. And, well, that's a good money-making tip. definitely do not rely on the world countries of to supply your army if you want to make a good headway into thwarting the alien menace and have, like, six bases like I have 4 months in. This is a real fun game that I like to just play, pick up and play whenever. I just want to show this game off, and I really liked the old school strategy elements that this game has. And you can still see a lot of the gameplay elements in, a recent title, Mario vs. Rabbids. It actually uses a lot of the same ideas in its gameplay. And I haven't actually played it, but I've seen videos of it online. This is just a fun game to play overall. You know what? Now that I'm looking at this thing here, I may not actually put a base in Antarctica. I might put one here in Australia, kind of near Sydney, or wherever it's played. Wherever it's, whatever the. I thought Australia had a city named Sydney on the East Coast, but apparently it's either not represented here on the world map, or perhaps they just feel like it's a city worth being on the world map. I might actually put one out here in Hawaii and have one cover the Pacific. Did I say specific or Pacific? Tongue-tied as usual. But I'd like to have as much global coverage as possible. And that last base, it's really a toss-up between Australia covering parts of Southeast Asia that these two bases won't cover, my Asian bases, or one in Pacific, because I found that late game a lot of alien crafts will first appear in the Pacific, and having just a listening base out there is a good idea to have. Also having one in Antarctica allows me to cover South America a little bit better, as well as Southern Africa. South America and Southern Africa. Anyway, I'm just kind of thinking about my strategy out loud here. But that's kind of what I just like playing this game. Also, one thing that's a good piece of advice is have some coverage out here in Europe. There are a lot of paying countries out here, France, Germany, Spain, Italy, UK, as well as the ones over here in Africa, Egypt, Nigeria. Nigeria, I think, is actually a pretty good country for funding, especially at game. South Africa, they're pretty rich too, so it's good to have a country over here in Africa. Having a couple in Asia, because Japan, I think, is the second best country as far as overall funds. China and India, gotta protect them too, as well as Russia. There's a lot of good countries in these general areas, and I definitely will have one in Australia at some time down the road, but that might be a couple months from where I'm at right now. But beyond that, that's just kind of how I've got my game set up and how my strategy is going so far. Once again, I hate alien infiltration missions, so I've got a lot of aircraft on my side to potentially destroy any battleships that may come my way, as well as salvage them when the time comes for an alien infiltration mission. And I'm just trying to prepare and get as many aircraft as I possibly can, which is why I've been abusing glitches and so on and so forth, and exploits to try and build and, you know, buy as many spacecrafts as I can, as well as weaponry to take down battleships, which battleships are very hard to take down early on in the game. They're the strongest alien aircraft out there, and they can down your normal aircraft in one shot. That's just how powerful they are. And so you need, like, several of the early game aircrafts and a boatload of luck if you want to take them down early on in the game, as well as some of the strongest weaponry, like the longest range missile that you can buy, longest range weaponry in general, and just, you need to have the good stuff early, or else you won't be able to take a battleship down. Just how it goes. Aside from that, this is SimSteven, also known as Mr. Federal. We're going to be ending this video here, and, well, this is a one-shot for XCOM UFO Defense. So, thanks for watching, and I hope you join me again for another one-shot episode, sooner or later, as well as my regular Let's Plays.